From the time it was first settled in the late 1700s, Glastonbury, Vermont has been plagued by hardship. The town's high altitude and rugged landscape made it a difficult place to live. Its location is remote, and the winds are infamous for their unpredictability. For many years, the town struggled to establish a thriving community. Things took a positive turn in the 1870s when Glastonbury became a hotspot for the logging industry. But with the end of the 19th century came the end of the business boom. With all of the natural resources stripped bare, it dried up and became a ghost town. In the 1930s, it was discovered that three members of the same family held every office and made up the entirety of the town. This led to Vermont's decision to disband Glastonbury. At the time, this was an unprecedented move by a state. Glastonbury Mountain was long rumored to be an epicenter of paranormal phenomena. This didn't change when the people fled. If anything, the activity in the area only increased. Today, Glastonbury Mountain is considered to be the heart of the Bennington Triangle, an area known for mysterious disappearances, strange lights, and Bigfoot and UFO sightings. The Triangle also includes the towns of Bennington, Somerset, Woodford, and Shaftesbury. The first to remark upon the unusual occurrences in the Triangle were the Native Americans. They called the mountain cursed, and only dared to venture there to bury the bodies of loved ones. They also believed that somewhere up on the mountain there was a large rock capable of swallowing a man alive. Legend has it that when an unsuspecting person would climb up on the rock, it would open up and devour them. While the Indians feared the land itself, the white settlers were more concerned with what may be lurking within it. After an incident in which a stagecoach was attacked by a hairy creature, stories began to circulate about the Bennington Monster. The Bennington Monster was described as being over 6 feet tall, covered in hair, and impossibly strong. And if a mysterious beast wasn't enough, there were also very real human threats. First, there was the wild man that lived somewhere deep in the woods. This wild man either had a sick sense of humor or he was extremely unwell. He spent the year of 1867 terrorizing the community of Glastonbury. He would threaten random strangers with a gun, and sometimes he would pull open his trench coat and flash the local women. Then there was the 1892 murder of John Crawley by Henry McDowell. McDowell and Crawley were employees at a sawmill in Fayetteville. At some point, McDowell began to hear voices in his head. At the voice's insistence, he bludgeoned Crawley to death. McDowell was committed to an asylum, but he managed to escape on a railroad car. To this day, there is no knowledge of what became of him. While the McDowell-Crawley incident is quite perplexing, the 1897 murder of John Harbor might just be stranger. Harbor was hunting deer with his friend and brother in the woods of Glastonbury. At some point, Harbor separated from the group. Later, the sound of a single rifle shot rang out, followed by a cry from Harbor saying he'd been shot. His brother and friend scrambled to find him, but shockingly, he was nowhere to be found. They finally located him the next day. His body was beneath a tree, and his gun was carefully propped up next to him. As they looked around, they noticed that Harbor had been shot a ways away, and somehow his body had ended up under the tree. It was never clear how it got there. There has been no shortage of odd occurrences in and around Glastonbury. But what really put the Triangle on the map of mysterious places were the string of disappearances that took place between 1945 and 1950. The disappearances began with seasoned hunting and fishing guide Mitty Rivers. On the day of November 12, 1945, Rivers was escorting a group of hunters back to camp when he seemingly vanished into thin air. He had gone ahead of the rest of the group, and the hunters assumed he would beat them to the campsite. But when they got there, Rivers was nowhere to be found. It was unlikely that he had gotten lost, since he was an experienced outdoorsman who was more than familiar with the area. They searched the region extensively, but the only evidence they ever found was a single rifle shell laying in a stream. The second disappearance came just 1 year later. 18-year-old Paula Weldon was a student at Bennington College. On the 1st of December 1946, she decided to take a hike along Vermont's famous Long Trail. In her bright red jacket, Weldon was easy to spot, and many people claimed to have seen her on the trail. An elderly couple claimed that Weldon was walking about 100 yards in front of them. They saw her turn a corner, then they never saw her again. There were no sounds, no calls of distress, and no indication as to where she might have gone. A large search party was formed to look for her. They left no rock unturned, and even offered a reward for any clues about her disappearance. But nothing was ever discovered. Some good did come of the whole ordeal, though. Weldon's father was unsatisfied with the investigation efforts. In response to his criticisms, Vermont decided to form its own state police, something they previously did not have. The next disappearance occurred exactly 3 years later, and it is by far the most puzzling. On December 1, 1949, James E. Tedford boarded a bus from St. Albans to Bennington. He had been visiting his family and was scheduled to return to the Bennington soldiers' home where he resided, but he never made it. There were only 14 passengers on the bus, and no one recalled Tedford getting off. In fact, some of the passengers explicitly stated that he was still on the bus after the last stop. It's hard to say for sure what exactly occurred, but when the bus reached its destination in Bennington, all that remained of Tedford was his timetable and his luggage. One interesting article noted that prior to his own disappearance, Tedford's wife had also vanished. The story goes that Tedford returned from military duty to find his wife completely gone. Now, this incident on its own seems rather mundane. There was a large age gap between the couple. She was 28 and he was 56. It's entirely possible that the age difference paired with the stress of war was enough to cause her to check out of the marriage. But when you factor in Tedford's fate, you begin to wonder if there's more to the story. Less than a year after Tedford disappeared, the Triangle claimed a child. On October 12, 1950, 8-year-old Paul Jepson was waiting in the truck while his mother went to feed the pigs. When she returned, he was nowhere to be found. His parents contacted the police, who set up a search party. Like Paula Weldon, Jepson was also wearing a bright red jacket, so he should have been easy to identify. They searched all over, but there was no sign of him. A bloodhound did manage to pick up the boy's scent and trace it all the way to the highway, but there were never any other leads. Some believed Jepson had been abducted by someone traveling on the road. Many others were convinced his parents had killed him, yet his parents maintained their innocence. His father claimed that young Paul had become obsessed with Glastonbury Mountain, saying he would talk about it all the time. He went as far as telling a reporter that his son may have been called away by the lure of the mountains. The last of the bizarre disappearances came just 2 weeks later. On October 28th, 53-year-old Frieda Langer was hiking with her cousin when she accidentally fell into a stream. Langer asked her cousin Herbert Elsner to wait for her while she ran back to the campsite. He agreed to wait, but as time went on, he began to get concerned. He walked back to the campsite to check on her, but she wasn't there. Her husband had stayed back while they went on the hike. When Elsner asked him where Langer was, he said that she had never returned. The National Guard, helicopters, police, and community members all searched for her, but were unable to locate the missing woman. Eventually, the search was called off, and life went on. But then 6 months later, Langer's body was discovered close to the Somerset Reservoir. Unfortunately, it had decomposed to the point where the cause of death could not be established. It should be noted that Langer's body was located in an area that had already been thoroughly searched. Those familiar with David Politis's work will know that this is a common hallmark of a missing 411 case. However, it is important to examine the missing 411 phenomena with skepticism, as many of its cases are less mysterious than Politis would have you believe. Today, there is still no explanation for the disappearances. One popular theory is that the missing people were victims of a serial killer. But most serial killers stick to a specific MO. All of the people that vanished were of varying ages and gender. In fact, there's really nothing to link the disappearances together, except for the location, time of year, and time of day, with most of the disappearances taking place between 3 and 4 p.m. While most have looked for a logical explanation, there are those who seem to agree with the natives and early settlers that the Triangle is a mystical place. One theory is that the missing people were abducted by aliens. Another theory states that the triangle is a window place. In other words, a doorway to another dimension. Even now, people claim to have odd experiences while camping or hiking. For example, Robert Singley, a professor at Bennington College, said that he'd gone for a hike only to find himself suddenly lost. He had been walking near the place Paula Weldon disappeared, when a fog appeared out of nowhere. Everything became very dark, and Singley found himself disoriented. When the fog had lifted enough, he realized he was completely off course from where he had been before. He was too confused to find his way back. Fortunately, he was later located by the police. There is another tale of a man named Dave, who had been working on restoring the fire tower up on Glastonbury Mountain. Dave said that his friends would tell him that he would become manic in his sleep, alternating between laughing and screaming. While there may be a practical explanation, the fact remains that 5 people, maybe more, have disappeared in the Bennington Triangle under mysterious circumstances, and only 1 body was ever found. More than 50 years have passed by, and it's unlikely we will ever know what happened to them. The stories of paranormal encounters could just be stories, and nothing more. Still, would you want to find yourself alone in the dark, up on Glastonbury Mountain? I will leave you with a quote from Algernon Blackwood's The Wendigo. The bleak splendors of these remote and lonely forests rather overwhelmed him with the sense of his own littleness. The stern quality of the tangled backwoods, which can only be described as merciless and terrible, rose out of these far blue woods swimming upon the horizon and revealed itself. He understood the silent warning. He realized his own utter helplessness. Thank you so much for watching. Please leave a like and subscribe if you haven't already done so. My name is Lola Tarantula, and I will see you next time.